I just absolutely love this slide because we are trained to focus on symptoms. And symptoms are important, right? To make the diagnosis in DSM, you have certain symptoms, you have to meet symptom threshold. And then, of course, many of our rating scales, especially the ones used in registration trials, are symptom-based rating scales, the MADRS, the HAM-D, and so on. But what really matters to patients is different. So if we look on the left, this is physicians' top 10 ranking of what they think is important in getting someone better. And you can see there's some symptoms there. On the right, and that's orange, on the right you see the blue ones, patients want life to be meaningful. Mm-hmm. They want to enjoy life. They want to be satisfied. They want to feel like themselves, right? Mm-hmm. So it's about quality of life and it's about wellness. So mm-hmm. I think it's important to take both into account. And something I like to say too is, you know, Roger, by the time a depressed patient comes to see us, they've been having symptoms for months often, right?
They have, and what this slide reminds me of is the attitudinal barriers that so often get in the way of optimal treatment outcomes, in the sense that when a patient comes after one or two treatments and things haven't been meaningful in terms of the improvement, no surprise, they rate psychotropic treatments as highly unsatisfactory. Yeah. And that highly unsatisfactory assessment, which is ubiquitous in the field, quite frankly, sets the stage in motion for kind of a vicious cycle. Yeah. In other words, we already know that attitudes toward the treatment greatly reflect the outcome on the treatment. Yeah. And this really creates a very vicious cycle for so many patients. I also conjecture, Andy, that this pivot towards positive mental health, well-being, the taketh away of illness does not giveth health, is in part what's behind the movement towards psychedelics. Ah. And the notion, the promise, that psychedelic treatments could offer benefits in positive mental health. Mm. And that's to be determined. We don't know that. Yep. But I think there's a part of that in that narrative.
I like it. I think you're right. We alluded to this earlier. Our definitions of a good outcome have evolved over time. We were very symptom-focused several years ago. We're moving towards remission. But we're moving beyond that now into a concept of wellness, positive mental health. We now talk about person-focused and really incorporating the patient's point of view into this. And so you can see that a key development has been the emergence of assessments looking at a sense of well-being and hope. And our friend Greg Mattingly has been really looking at resilience, and Rakesh Jain has been looking at resilience. So following this shift in perspective, there's been an increased interest in subjective outcomes, and the FDA is now really wants to see PROs, patient-reported outcomes. Mm-hmm. I love what you said before. The absence of mental distress does not guarantee well-being.
That's right.
Right.